Hi, I'm Dr. Phil Busey, and I'm teaching you about irrigation. Whether you have a large sprinkler, such as this gun and hose reel combination on a sod farm, or you have a small spray head or rotary head in someone's landscape, the principles are the same. One of the principles is that most sprinklers of all types go around in a circle somehow, and they apply a circular distribution of water with more concentration near the center. And we use this in our irrigation drawings. We also need to consider that it's really the nozzle that does the work. This particular nozzle, which is quite big, can deliver a large flow of water. And that flow can cover a pretty large radius. So whether we're talking about small spray heads or large guns such as this, we need to know what nozzle we're using, and we need to know the pressure at the nozzle to determine both the radius and the flow. And those are the basic bookkeeping details that need to be looked up in the irrigation sprinkler table in order to design a proper irrigation system. A proper irrigation system is going to have those circles overlap in a way that's sometimes called head-to-head coverage, where the throw from one center of a circle reaches its neighbors. And I'll be talking more about a square distribution versus an equilateral, which is really an equilateral triangular distribution. Those are two ways that we can achieve good overlap with the purpose of having more uniform irrigation coverage. Well, it's going to get a little wet here, so I think we need to be moving on elsewhere. This landscape irrigation system is completely inefficient because it was designed improperly. The sprinklers fixed in the ground do not have head-to-head coverage. In fact, they don't even overlap. As a result, the one time of the year in the dry season when we would like the irrigation to actually do something, it fails. It leaves us these green islands in a sea of brown. If this were designed on a layout, either square or equilateral, with head-to-head coverage and overlap, it would be far more efficient. We could use less water, and we could still have green grass. To show you how square or equilateral sprinkler layout in an irrigation drawing can assure excellent irrigation overlap between sprinklers, as well as head-to-head coverage, I wanted to pick a particular sprinkler. Because the shape and size of the landscape, I picked a rotary sprinkler with a 20-foot radius, of which several manufacturers have examples. The one in particular I have is a Rainbird 3500. And the reason I picked this is that it comes complete as a kit of interchangeable nozzles. So depending upon our radius requirements and the available pressure, we should be able to get a 20-foot radius. And how can I verify that that is the case? Because the manufacturer's sprinkler table tells us that for a particular pressure and nozzle, there will be a certain radius, and it will also tell us the flow and precipitation rate. So let's go design. Putting pipe in the ground is the easy part of irrigation if there is a good design plan as an irrigation drawing. As a part of irrigation design, I will show you how to do sprinkler layout in a lawn area of 200 feet by 120 feet using a 20-foot radius rotary sprinkler. It's very important to have uniform coverage within the landscape area, as well as to have no irrigation applied to impervious areas outside. The steps in irrigation design must be done in precise order. Any variation on this is going to cause mistakes and require doing the job all over again. For example, some of the first things that one must do is to have an objective for irrigation,
to do a site assessment and make sure there's a source of water. Irrigation layout, which is steps 6 and 7, only comes after these earlier steps. Step 1 in irrigation design includes site assessment. Visit the landscape and determine if there are uniquely different microenvironments. Are there different groupings of plants with different water requirements? And what's the area going to be used for? Are there areas of the landscape that will receive considerable shade, which will reduce the evapotranspiration requirements? Are there ground covers that require a different level of irrigation? Is there white pavement that will be potentially stained by irrigation water? Among the irrigation design steps before sprinkler layout, there is a need to draw the property and block off and measure different shaped areas to decide what kind of sprinkler radius fits in each area independently. Today's sprinkler layout exercise involves Area 1, which is 200 feet by 120 feet, but it is part of a larger landscape with other areas of different shapes. While Area 1, which we'll work on now, is large enough for rotary sprinklers, Areas 2 and 3 are narrow, only 15 feet wide, and they would be suitable for spray sprinklers. Continuing with the idea of doing irrigation design steps in precise order, there are some things that will be done only after the sprinkler layout has been accomplished. For example, step number 8 involves grouping sprinklers in zones, drawing and sizing the pipes, the branches, the valves, the main line, adding a legend and label the valves and other features. The big challenge of sprinkler layout involves water distribution. This is because sprinklers deposit a large mound of water close to the center where the sprinkler head is, and with less and less water out around the fringes. On the side view on the left, you can see there's no overlap, whereas on the right, there is head-to-head spacing, which effectively stacks the water from neighboring sprinklers so that the areas of thin distribution overlap. Looking down, you can see that on the left, there are large gaps, areas that are not being irrigated at all or enough, whereas on the right, there is excellent coverage within the area spanned. I will come back in a minute to head-to-head coverage, because another big challenge in sprinkler layout is finding what diameter of circle will fit the landscape area a whole multiple of times. For our 200 feet by 120 feet landscape area, there is a circle of 40 feet in diameter, which meets that requirement. Usually we first look at the narrower dimension of an area for irrigation, because that is determinative of what size circles will fit. And a 40-foot circle will fit 3 times on the 120-foot side. And a 40-foot diameter circle also fits this area perfectly in the other dimension, which is 200 feet. These are whole multiples without fractions. Sometimes the spacing can be slightly reduced for fit if the numbers come out just a little bit off. Now that we have chosen to have a sprinkler with a 40-foot diameter of coverage, we divide that by 2 to determine the radius needs to be 20 feet, and we find if there's a sprinkler that qualifies. There is. The Rainbird 3500 series is such a sprinkler. If it is operated at 25 pounds per square inch with a nozzle number 1.0, it will provide a 20-foot radius. Placing 20-foot radius circles in our landscape of 200 feet by 120 feet fits fine. We can merely put rows and columns in. But notice that there's no overlap. What's going to happen? What's going to happen is what you've already seen, green islands in a sea of brown. This is wasteful and inefficient. It means that the person who manages this irrigation is going to water and water to try to get some drops out to those brown areas while over-irrigating the green areas that already don't need it. You might be able to live with brown grass, but wasting water is unacceptable. To achieve adequate uniformity, we need to double up the number of sprinklers in each direction to give head-to-head coverage. Now, with head-to-head coverage, we have excellent uniformity in the interior of the landscape area, but it's going to be brown and dry around the outside. There are no sprinklers to provide overlap on the perimeter, and there are some areas here in white which actually have no irrigation at all. So we're going to have to go back to the drawing board, and this time we're going to start from the outside in. Start with the grid. Since we'll be placing sprinklers with the 20-foot radius, we start with a square grid, a 20-foot squares, and we will place sprinklers wherever the lines will cross. But first, we'll put four corner sprinklers, adjust those to a 90-degree one-quarter circle, add circles around the entire perimeter, adjust those to 180 degrees, half circle. And now fill in the interior with full circle sprinklers. This is head-to-head spacing on a square layout. There's excellent overlap, and there's high distribution uniformity because each spot receives irrigation from two or more sprinklers. The square layout pattern is based on squares. There is another layout pattern called equilateral. It is based on triangles because these are equilateral triangles, and it's somewhat more difficult to conceive because the rows are spaced 87% the distance of the square layout. So where before there were six rows in the grid, with the equilateral layout, there are now seven. And every other sprinkler row has the sprinklers offset half a radius. And this is what equilateral layout will look like after sprinklers are placed. Some of the arcs will need to be adjusted on the ends. And then on the top and the bottom, there will necessarily be a little bit of overspray, which may be acceptable. The equilateral layout is challenging, but each spot receives irrigation from three or more sprinklers. This gives the equilateral layout considerable resistance to the effects of wind. Both square and equilateral sprinkler layout have some things in common. In both cases, the sprinklers are spaced at the radius of coverage. Secondly, the perimeters must be filled in with partial circle arcs, which is typically done at the beginning of the drawing process. And then if sprinklers are not matched precipitation, and that would be the case for rotary sprinklers, different arcs will later have to be assigned to different zones with the run times adjusted proportionately. As to the choice between square or equilateral sprinkler layout, it comes down mostly to balancing the difficulty of the design with the equilateral and the benefit of the equilateral in having a degree of resistance to the wind effect. Both square and equilateral designs can be used in landscapes of different sizes and shapes, although square fits better with rectangular landscapes. In summary, sprinkler layout occurs intermediate among the steps in irrigation design. Sprinkler layout must be done after some preliminaries, including, most importantly, measuring different shaped areas of the landscape for assignment to sprinklers of different radii that fit those shapes. Sprinkler layout is done on an irrigation drawing before assigning those sprinklers into zones, drawing the pipes and other features. The overall goal of sprinkler layout is to achieve maximum possible irrigation uniformity. Irrigation in all its forms around the world involves a precious resource, water. Water must be used efficiently. In the case of sprinklers, it requires uniformity of distribution, whether it be a small set of misters in a shade house or a large center pivot irrigation system on a commercial sod farm. The use of sprinklers is very widespread. Even with new and better kinds of sprinklers and other advancing technologies to improve the efficiency of overhead irrigation, sprinkler layout is fundamental because it tackles the problem of fitting circular water distributions into rectangular areas. Thank you for your attendance and help. Now let us learn everything we need to know about irrigation.